Hi, myself Naveen Kumar Saini. In the course of wireless and mobile communication, code REC085, today in lecture 5, we will discuss some topics about the cellular theory. So, what are topics? Cellular frequency reuse, handoff, channel assignments, and the interferences. So, here, what is the first topic is the cellular frequency reuse. So, this is one of the very prominent topic in the cellular system or in cellular theory. So, what is that? The operation about the frequency reuse we will discuss. So, a radio channel which consists of a pair of frequencies for full duplex. Okay. So, for full duplex operation. Next, the concept of frequency reuse, which is based on assigning to each cluster that the same group of radio channels used within the small geographical area. So, here a set of n adjacent cells and shared among the spaced system in the cellular system. Okay. So, the set of frequencies which is assigned to a cell is completely different from the assigned to the neighboring cell. Next topic that is about in frequency reuse, that is the footprint. So, what is the footprint? So, this terminology is what? The coverage area of the cell is called the footprint, which is surrounded by the outer boundary of the cell. So, if they are the, just for example, if you are taking the 7 members in a cluster of the available frequency, then the set of set will be 7. Okay. Then the frequency reuse factor will be 1 upon 7. So, this means that each cell uses 1/7 of the available channel, cellular channel of the for reuse. Okay. So, this is the concept for the frequency reuse. So, in mathematical expression, we can specify how to get the 1.7 and how to use the concept of frequency reuse. So, for that we are taking the L, this is the total number of duplex channels which is available for reuse. That means, we can say that the frequency per cluster. Then small k, this is the number of duplex channels allotted to each cell of the cluster. So, here k must be less than L. Next is n. N is the cluster size in which there will be the n cells in each cluster. M is what? M is the number of times the cluster is repeated. If in a cellular system there is a m number of clusters are there, then the total capacity we can calculate, or we can say the total effective numbers of duplex channels available in the area, that will be C is equal to m cross L. Okay. So, where L is what? L is the k into n. So, total capacity or the total effective number of duplex channels will be L is capacity will be m k n. So, we can see this thing in the structure itself. In this figure, there is a cluster of the 3 cells. This is just for example here. Then set of frequency F1 is in for the cell 1, F2 is in the cell 2, and F3 is in the cell 3. So, these are set of frequencies which is mentioned in the given cells. And in this complete set is called the one cluster. So, similarly, we have the second cluster in the second cluster in a cellular system. So, in this way now, we can define the cell reuse factor also when you are using, just for example, 7 cells in a cluster. So, in this cell we can see this. So, this one is the cell number 1, this is the cell number 2, this is the cell number 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. So, this complete structure is the one cluster. So, as I am mentioning here, so this set is the one cluster. Similarly, so we have the another cluster like this, and we have the another cluster like this. So, in the each cluster, there are the 7 number of cells, and each cell will have the k number duplex channels, which is allotted to each cell, as I just mentioned. Okay, so like this, defining the number of cells within a cluster is very important. Okay, so if the cluster size n is reduced, the while keeping the cell size constant, then more clusters which can be required to cover a given area, and hence more capacity is achieved. But to get the n in a specified manner, in a specified manner, this is a very tricky thing. So n cannot be large or n cannot be very small. Okay, but if we have the n is small, then we can cover more. We can use the more clusters in the given system. But if conversely, if we have a small cluster size, which indicates that the co-channel cells are located must closer together, then which will rise to a co-channel interference. Okay, so thus from the design viewpoint, the smallest possible value of n is desirable in order to maximize the capacity over the given coverage area. So this is the terms which is used for getting the to optimize the value of n. Next is the handover. So this is the second term which is used in the cellular theory, that is the handover procedure. So what is the handover? Handover or the handoff, both are same things. When we are moving from one cluster of one cell to the another cell, then the moving from one cell to another cell, then duration between this movement will be takes place during the handover or the handoff. It means if we are calling in one cell and we are moving into the another cell, then the handover handover process will takes place. So in this example, few categorization of the handovers are like hard handover, soft, and the softer handovers. So in this example, we will discuss about the hard handover scenario. In that, we have the one base station A, and the base station B, and the base station C. Now this car is moving from the base station. The cell A, cell 1, which has the base station A, and it is moving into the cell 2, which has the base station 2. So when this car is moving from here to here, then the handover will take place. So here it is mentioned that communication bit interrupted, interruption during moving from A base station to B base station, or you can say switching from the base station A to base station B. Okay, so in during this, the handover will take place. So all this scenario will be controlled by the switch, cellular switch, that is MTSO, mobile telecommunication switching office. So this guy will takes place about the handover processor or the handover when it is moving from cell 1 to cell 2. So it is also, it must be there must be some margin when it is moving from 1 to 2. So this margin will be given, maybe takes place by this margin of the handover. Okay, it is also mentioned here when the mobile phone is in the region of base station A and it is moving into base station B, then the signal strength will be reduced up to this level. So then the handoff will be start. So when it is moving from here to here, then up to here the maximum you can say up to here the completely it will be changed from base station A to base station B. Okay, so when it is now, when at this point this mobile phone is reaching, then it will be connected with the base station B, okay. So what is the margin of this one? So this margin is given by the margin probability of the in the handover system. Okay, so here the probability of handover is the very less, because it is in the in the connection with the base station A, and when it is moving in this direction, then in this case the probability will be medium and then the probability will be high. So probability of handover will be very high at this, in this region, okay. And when it is moving into this, in this case what will happen again, the handover will take place completely and this mobile phone will reaching into the base station 2 and it will be represented here. So this here the handoff termination will be takes place completely. So these things can be explained in the hysteresis loop, where the margin we can calculate from here to here, okay. Then there is some terminology in the handovers. So what are those? First is the handoff probability. So it is the probability that a handoff is executed before call termination, okay. Second is the rate of handover. So it is the number of handovers per unit time. Third one is the interruption duration. So it is duration of the time during a handover processor in which mobile is not connected to any base station. Third one is the handoff delay. So it is the distance between the point at which the handoff should occur and the point at which it does occur, okay. So third terminology in the handover procedure is the probability of unsuccessful handoff. So it is the probability that a handoff is executed while the reception conditions are inadequate. Fourth is the next final is that handoff blocking probability. So it is a probability which that the handover cannot be completed successfully. So these all are the terminology which is used for the handoff processor. So this is the margin where del is the PR handoff minus PR minimum. So in that, so what is the criteria for the del? So this del should not be too large or too small. So this will be margin where if del is too large, then unsuccessful handover will takes place, okay. So if it is too small, then there will be insufficient time to complete a handoff before a call is lost, okay. So this may be the due to the weak signal conditions. So this margin of handover will be chosen very carefully, okay. So these here, then the handoff which can occur only if the new base station is sufficiently stronger than the current one of our handover margin, okay. So the effect of the handover is called the ping pong effect when it is moving from one base station to another base station, and this procedure can exhibits the hysteresis. And there are different two strategies are used for the handovers. So first one is a centralized and the decentralized procedures. So these are the methods of the handoff. So these are mobile assisted handoff and the base station assisted handoff. So the in mobile assisted handoff, the mobile measures the power received from the surrounding base stations and continuously reports the result of the measurements to serving base station. Okay, so the handoff is which is initiated when the power received from the base station of a neighboring cells begins to exceed that from the current base station by a certain level or certain period of time. So this method is currently used in today's mobile system, but in the case of base station assisted handoff, so in this it was used in the first generation system where the MTSO will takes place, the criteria between the movement or when the your mobile phone is moving from the one base station to towards the another base station region, okay. So the MTSO, the mobile telecommunication switching center, will decide about the switching from the one base station to the second base station, okay. So the soft handovers, so this handover generally utilized in the CDMA based system. So where it has the ability to select between the instantaneous received signals from the variety of the base station. It depends if there are many base stations are there and the mobile phone is switching from the one base station to another base station. So very intelligently the mobile phone system can change the signal, it can go into the another base station which has a very stronger signal strength, okay, it can decide. So, this is the soft handover. So, next is the channel assignment. So, their channel assignment is what, if we have a mobile phone is in the one base station or in the region of one base station in one cell, so how to select the channels, okay, so how to assign the channels to the particular user. So, for that we have the processor like fixed channel assignment. So, in that, in the fixed channel assignment method, each cell is allocated a predetermined set of voice channels, and only the unused channels in the particular cell can serve any call attempt within that cell. If all the channels are occupied, then the cell will be blocked and the subscriber will not get the any service. Okay, so this is the fixed channel assignment. Next is the borrowing strategy. So, in that the borrowing strategy is cell is allowed to borrow a channel from the neighboring cell. So, if all of its channels are occupied, okay, then MSC, Mobile Service Center, it supervises the borrowing procedure and ensure that the borrowing of the channel does not disrupt or interfere with any of the call in the progress in any donor cell. So, this is the borrowing strategy. Next is dynamic channel assignment. So, this is the last one which has the in the dynamic channel assignment, it in method the voice channel are not allocated permanently as it was used in the fixed channel assignment. So, it dynamically it can be changed. So, when a call request is made, then the serving base station request is request a channel from the MSC. So, when then allocates a channel to the requested cell. So, it depends upon the request. So, channel assignment will takes place, okay, based on demand the channel assignment will be takes place. So, say there is some advantages of the dynamic channel assignment. So, it can reduce or likely of blocking, call blocking can be reduced and the core channel interference reduces and channel utilization can be increased. But there is a disadvantage also is that the MSC must be fast and capable of collecting the real time data on the channel occupancy. So, it depends also the channel conditions. So, based on that the signals can be transmit or the received and the channel channel assignment can takes place. Okay, so cellular interference. So, this cellular interference is what in which when the mobile phone is moving from the one there is an interference in when it is the signal strength is changing from low to high or high to low. So, in that case the interference of the signals can be takes place. So, this channel can be takes place when the handoff margin is very less and there is a when there is a less number of channels also. So, for that there are two strategies are there, two types of cellular interferences are there, core channel interference and the adjacent channel interference. Okay. So, here it mentioned that core channel interference due to this scenario we can see there are three tiers, system is there, this is the tier 1. So, this is the tier 1, this is the tier 2 and this is the tier 3. So, it depends the where the mobile phone is or the mobile system is there, it is in tier 1 or it is in tier 2 or it is in tier 3. So, based on that the mobile handover can takes place or the interference can be takes place. So, here there is a one formula that is signal to interference where the core channel, we are talking about the core channel interference. So, in that the core channel cells surrounding a particular cell which exists in a circular pattern. Okay. So, there will be the maximum interference from the nearest cell, circle of the cells, which are also called the first tier cells. And always 6 in the numbers. So, this is the first tier, okay, which is based on the signal to interference of the mobile receiver. So, what is the significance of that? If the mobile phone is connected with one particular cell, okay, desired cell, so that the maximum signal strength can be received. But the other cells which is around that cell, like in cluster, so if the cluster in a given cluster one base station is connected with particular desired mobile phone, then other cells will create the interference. Okay, so we can see in the diagram in this expression that signal to interference is equal to signal. This is a signal. This is a desired signal, and rest of the rest of the base stations creates the interference. Okay, suppose we have the seven cell structure. So in that, one will be the desired cell. Okay, desired cell. So rest six will be undesired. So in this case, so it will be the I1 to I6. Okay, so this is the undesired. So this will create the interference. So here that S represent the desired signal power from the desired base station, and it is the interference power of the base station of the ith interfering co-channel cells. Okay, so we can represent it in terms of D by R ratio. Okay, so this is signal to interference is the this is D by R ratio, and in place of S by I. So in this case, here n is what? This n is the path loss, so which we will discuss in the upcoming lectures. Okay, so signal to interference will be r ki power minus n upon sigma i minus 1 to 6 and d I ki power minus n. So this concept also we will discuss in our upcoming lectures. So here this is the co-channel reuse ratio. Okay, so the expression of this one can be also explained as the S is equal to k into r ki power minus 1. So where k is the proportionality constant, which depends on the power radiated by the base station at the center. So and I, it represents the power radiated by the other base stations in the first tier, and the which are 6 in the numbers, as I have just mentioned in the last previous slide. So the interference, it can be your 6k into d ki power minus n. So in that case, when you use the above equations, then S by I will be after solving this, it will be 1 by 6 into 3 n ki power n by 2. So where n should be designed critically for the desired SIR. So this is the signal to interference ratio. So this is next is SINR for the adjacent channel interference. So where the adjacent channel interference can be minimized through the carefully fitting the IF stages, when we have the intermediate amplifiers, if we are using, or the frequency use factors as we are using, and carefully channel assignment. So based on that, we can reduce the adjacent channel interference. So formula for that is the S by R is equal to 20 ki power minus n. So this portion which represent the interference between the channel 1 and channel 2. So we have to select, we have to assign the channels in that way that this portion must be minimized. So this is a desired mobile B with power low power, and this is the interfering mobile A with high power, where the overlapping the desired frequencies. So next and the last, this is the sectorization. So as we have discussed in the last lecture itself, the sectorization is used to utilize the frequencies efficiently, and based on the urban and rural areas, we sectored the mobile, we sectored the cellular system. In the system or the scenario where we said about the femtocell, microcell, picocell and all. Okay, so in that we can see that sectorized base stations are created by the subdividing an omni cell into sectors. So that are covered using the directional antennas mounted in the same base station. Okay, so this is the example of three sector division which is mentioned here, and each sector is treated as the different cell. Okay, so based on the different antennas, just like directive antenna, right? In the previous lecture, we have discussed about the n type of antennas of the base station. There is the omnidirectional and directional antennas. So here I just mentioned about the base station contains the directed antennas. So it may be the phase of sectorized base station with directional 120 degree beam width antenna. Okay. So next is all these things are mentioned in a given cell. So this is the base, this is the antenna set 1, this is the antenna set 2, and this is the antenna set 3. So which is of the 120 degree of beam width for this cellular system. So this cellular system, in a cellular system, if one cell is there, so this complete cell can be bifurcated by using the different antennas. So here it mentioned to sectorize a cell, a horizontal, a equilateral platform resembling a triangle is deployed on a tower. So each side of the platform is called the face. So face, a face, 3, 4, or 6 directional antennas are installed on the platform. So it is depending on the number of sectors. So that is why sectorization is very, very important in the cellular system. So which will help to utilize the given spectrum, and by using the low power antennas at the small cells, so that we can service to the more number of subscribers or the mobile phones in a given area, just for example of urban areas. So why we require this sectorization? So sectorization facilities facilitate that the wireless engineering and operations in the following ways. So what are those? It minimizes or eliminates core channel interference. And second, it optimizes the frequency reuse plane, and this is facilitated through another concept is known as the front to back ratio. Okay, so at the minimum, it triples the capacity of any given coverage area when the compared to the capacity offered by the deployed omni antennas. In some applications, we use the omni antennas, but in our wireless communication system, we use the directional antennas. So the concept of the multiple input, multiple output also takes place when we use in the cellular system. Okay, so where the more number of antennas we use at the base station, and these antennas may be of your omnidirectional or the directional antennas. Okay, so if we want more coverage or more spectrum, or I mean if we want more spectral efficiency, then for that we use the multiple input multiple output antenna concept, where the particular only one user can be serviced by the different antennas. Okay, so based on that we use different structures of the antennas. So those structures we will discuss in our upcoming lectures. So how to utilize that antennas efficiently, and how to use the given spectrum very efficiently. So this will be our task to perform it. Okay, so thank you very much from my side. So in the next lecture, we will cover about the some part of fading part or some morals about the channel. Okay, thank you very much.